Good morning, everyone. Welcome to this new Sunday here in this new month of February 2024, this fourth day of February. It's great that you could join us here today, and you will already have noticed, certainly from the introductory theme for our online service today, but certainly just seeing here this wonderful masterpiece of Raphael, that we commence this day a 10-week journey looking at inspirational pieces of art that really do speak to our spirit and speak into the context of our faith today. And this day, we begin that journey in looking at the Renaissance masterpiece by Raphael, the Disputation of the Holy Sacrament. And I know that we will receive something good from the reflection that we make upon this inspirational work this day. Of course, we will explore this amazing, intricate masterpiece just a little later in this online service. It's great that you've joined us here today at the beginning of this series. I always love the start of a new series as we move into something. And I know that over the next 10 weeks, we're going to be blessed. We're going to be educated. We're going to be perhaps challenged on some occasions, but certainly drawn closer to God through the amazing creativity of the artists that we will engage with. It's great to be here today to begin this series. It's great to be here with you watching and very much a part of our online service community here at Sunshine Salvos. At Sunshine Salvos this week, we've been back into the regular swing of things. At our center, we've had our welfare program running up to full speed, and certainly it's been busy in this past week. We've just come back a couple of days ago with our regular Friday night community meal that was very well frequented. Many people have inquired when it was coming back. They've missed getting their regular meals for the weekend from Sunshine Salvos, so our Friday night team were welcomed back with open arms by our Sunshine community. It was great to be there, really making a difference in a real way again on Friday nights. All of our programs are just about back up to speed. I'll have a talk about the month of February as it stands in front of us in the announcements, because there's a fair bit on in February that we'll get to in just a little while. Of course, we come this day, no matter where we are, especially in this great Southland of Australia. We gather in our own spaces, but yet together we gather on traditional lands. And I want to invite a First Nations voice, Tahana Turner, who's going to come this day and share with us the welcome to country and acknowledgement of the traditional custodians of the land where you and I are gathered today. Thank you, Tahana.
Jingiwala Jimbalans, hello friends. Wherever you are in this great country, let us all honour and praise Navangali, our creator God who formed this incredible land. As we gather today on different countries, we acknowledge the traditional custodians whom creator God has entrusted custodianship over these amazing countries. We respect the enduring connection the traditional custodians have with creation and with the Creator. Everything we touch and everything we see, we appreciate their care and connection to this land. We remember our ancestors of the past and our elders who are present with us. Their stories and knowledge will be passed on for the generations that are to come. Remember that wherever you are standing today, you are standing on sacred ground.
And I add to that, the commitment of the Salvation Army Australia Territory, we will continue to walk alongside First Nations people, achieving justice for them in the spirit of reconciliation and providing a voice for First Nations people wherever and whenever necessary. The lands where you find yourself and where I am today, they were never ceded. They were, they are. They always will remain Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander lands. And we begin with a prayer, as we always do. This prayer is appropriate for the theme of our online service this day, and it's entitled Homecoming. Would you join with me as we commence this worship time in prayer? Ever welcoming God, we give you thanks and praise that when you were still far off, you met us in your Son, Jesus, and you brought us home. By dying and by living, Jesus declared his love, and he gave us his grace, and he opened to us the gate of glory. May we who share Christ's body, who live his risen life, we who drink his cup, bring life to others. We whom the Spirit lights, give light to the world. Lord, keep us firm in the hope you have set before us, so we and all your children shall be free, and the whole earth live to praise your name. And we pray this prayer through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. There's a beautiful Salvation Army song that is one of those songs that really has a melody to it that you would describe as being haunting. It stays with you and it speaks to you, especially the words, burning, burning, always burning. It's a song that talks about the Spirit of God and how there is a continual work within us, that the Spirit is burning, burning, as we yearn and yearn to know more of God and to feel his presence and guidance within us. We're going to sing that song as the opening song of our worship service this day. Burning, burning, always burning. Thank you. it's the burning within us of the Spirit who intercedes for us when we pray. The words that we can't speak, the Spirit speaks for us as we lift our hearts and our minds and our emotions, our energy to God in prayer. We do that together as a community of faith, in unity, joining with each other, our hearts, our prayers this day. Would you join with me this day as we pray for those concerns of our world, of our nation, of our community, and the people we love at Sunshine Salvos? Let's pray. Amen. Some announcements I have for this day, and I referenced them just a little while ago, of course. Here I have our newsletter for the month of February, the Year of the Dragon edition of our Sunshine Salvos newsletter. Of course, this is on our Sunshine Salvos Facebook group page. You can download it there, you can consult it, see what's relevant and what's happening at Sunshine Salvos this month, and I tell you, there's a fair bit going on. And I start with the blokes, because next Saturday, fellas, we have our Lunar New Year of the Dragon Yum Cha lunch. Sounds like it's going to be a great day. It will be a great day. That takes place at 11:30 a.m. at the Oriental Tea House at 379 Little Collins Street in Melbourne. It's going to be a great, great lunch experience right in the middle of Melbourne's central business district, right in the middle of Lunar New Year. I'm sure there's going to be dragons, there's going to be dumplings, there's going to be all things good about that lunch, blokes. So get along. That's next Saturday, the 10th of February. You can see me for more details about that. Ladies, you're not missing out, because the next Saturday, there is the very first Shine activity for 2024. Ladies, you will be enjoying a beautiful fish and chip afternoon lunch on the beach foreshore at Altona. We've done those before. They're a great day. Just a beautiful way for the ladies to start their Shine year. That's Saturday the 17th of February at 12 midday. Other announcements include the following Saturday after the Shine event, the 24th, there'll be a Bunnings barbecue, and that will be taking place at Caroline Springs all day. If you want to be a part of the barbecue team, let us know. We'll make sure we get you in there to cook some sausages or two. Also, for the month of February, we will see the commencement on Sundays in our gathered worship of the Self-Denial Appeal series. That's an annual appeal that the Salvation Army organized to draw our attention to the work of the Salvation Army in developing countries around the world, but to also allow Salvation Army members in our worship centers right across Australia to prepare their hearts to make an offering so that we can substantially, in a real way, set about transforming the lives of people in disadvantaged circumstances in the developed world whom the Salvation Army are working with. And the Salvation Army does wonderful work with people around the world. That Self-Denial series will be beginning in February and will culminate and conclude in March. The other announcement I wanted to draw your attention to is that at Sunshine Salvos, on a couple of Sundays, Sunday the 18th of February and Sunday the 25th of February, we will be holding two information sessions that talk about what it means to be a member of the Salvation Army. You know, it's really important. We love all the people who come along to Sunshine Salvos in our gathered worship. Of course, we love you here, those who regularly tune in to our online service. But we really do want to encourage people to become members of the Salvation Army, either by becoming an adherent member or becoming a soldier of the Salvation Army. We're giving information about that on Sunday the 18th and Sunday the 25th of February, directly following our gathered worship service, about 11:30 to 12:30, straight after the service. Of course, there's our February prayer list for people at Sunshine Salvos to pray for. They're listed there. Please keep our dear friends in your prayers. And the timetable's on the back, of course, for everything going on in the month of February. I'll leave the announcements there, but remember, this is on our Sunshine Salvos Facebook group page. Check it out there, consult it, see what's happening for you at Sunshine Salvos this month. There's a fantastic song by Matt Redman that directly speaks about the notion of remembrance. And it particularly speaks about remembrance in the way and form of communion. This wonderful song we're going to sing together, it speaks of the way we remember Jesus through the way of participating in communion. The bread, his body, and of course, the wine, signifying his blood. We remember Jesus as he taught us to do. This song speaks into the heart of remembrance. Would you join with me as we sing this day in our own remembrance of what Jesus has done for us?
You are making us faithful, Lord. We Jesus, come. By your mercy we come to your table. By your grace you are making us faithful. Lord, we remember you. And remembrance leads us to worship. As we worship you, our worship leads to communion. We respond to your invitation. We respond to your invitation. We remember
quick Bible reading that very much directly relates to what we've just sung about, but also relates, of course, to the essence of this magnificent piece of art, which we're just about to get to. In Matthew's Gospel, we read in Matthew 26, verses 26 to 30, we read the following. While they were eating, Jesus took bread, gave thanks, and broke it. And he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body." Then he took the cup, he gave thanks, and he offered it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. I tell you, I will not drink of this fruit of the vine from now on until the day when I drink it anew with you in my Father's kingdom." May God add wisdom to that reading, how we understand it in the context it was written, and how we understand it in the context of today. This magnificent art piece by Raphael, famous Renaissance artist, really does speak of the power, the meaning, the symbolism of communion, or Eucharist, or as many would call it from the original Latin, the monstrosa. And it's right there as the central focus within this artwork. This artwork, of course, was commenced in 1509 and finished a couple of years later in 1511 by Raphael. It was painted on a fresco and still has its place within the Vatican in the Apostolic Palace, a magnificent piece of art called the Disputation of the Holy Sacrament. I'm going to talk about what this scene symbolizes, what it represents, what's going on within it in just a moment, but as is the practice of how I will guide you in these online services through the contemplation of these magnificent pieces of art, I'm going to give you a few minutes to just one-on-one, you and this magnificent piece of art, to contemplate, to take note, to absorb the warmth of the colours, the richness, the detail in this masterpiece. I'm going to give you just a few minutes to intimately do that right now. Raphael's masterpiece, the Disputation of the Holy Sacrament. There's such a lot of detail in this painting. It represents at its heart two levels of reality. On one level, underneath the clouds here, you have this host of people, diverse people. They're often called the church militant within the meaning of this painting. There is a variety of people there. There are common folk. There's a fellow right there in the corner who looks almost as if he is of Asian extraction. A diversity of people. There are church people. There are philosophers. I look at this particular gentleman here in orange and blue and am drawn to the fact that he represents Aristotle, the famous Greek philosopher. And there are other religious figures of note here. On this bottom earthly level, of all of these people with their books on the steps, all seemingly deep in discussion, deep in contemplation, some in dispute and argument as to this centerpiece of this masterpiece, the sacrament, the bread, the body of Christ, there at the very center on the altar. And this is a very historical piece, which has a definite historical context, because it has often been argued about the depth of meaning and symbolism of the Eucharist or communion, the sacrament. And that is exactly what's going on amongst all of these figures here in the earthly realm within Raphael's painting here. All having their own opinion, all wanting to express their view of exactly what this bread means, this body of Christ. And this was a real debate. This was a real situation of dispute and differing opinions in the church at the time. We're talking about 1509 to 1511 that this masterpiece was painted. And it's around that time that we started to get real schisms in the church. Of course, it's early, but it's certainly not so far away that we start to be introduced within the history of Christendom to the figure of Martin Luther and the eventual split of the Catholic Church into two main streams, Catholicism and Protestantism. Of course, the Eastern Orthodox tradition is already well and truly established. But there is a lot of debate going on within church circles as to what this sacrament means. And so on an earthly level, all of these figures are there debating, what is this sacrament really about? What does it mean? What are we partaking of when we eat of the bread that we believe is the body of Christ, or at least representative of the body of Christ? There are some notable historical figures in this group and menagerie of people in the earthly realm under the clouds here. There are people such as Gregory the Great, Saint Jerome, Saint Augustine, Saint Ambrose. There are popes there in their papal mitres and robes. Pope Julius II, Pope Sixtus IV. There are other thinkers, theologians within the church. There is Dante Alighieri, the famous author of Dante's Inferno, there. And there are others as well, Savonarola. There is St. Thomas Aquinas in there somewhere. Ah, there he is, right there, with his saintly halo. And there are other historical figures who are very much a part of this gathering of debaters and commentators and seekers of truth after what this sacrament means. Of course, at the heart of this debate is the sacrament, the bread, representing the body of Christ. And at stake within this disputation is, what is the depth of meaning and symbolism or significance or substance of this bread? You see, within the Catholic tradition, there is always and still remains a theology that the bread is a transubstantiation. That means that when you eat of the bread in remembrance of Christ, then the bread in a mystical way transforms its substance from being bread into being the actual flesh of Christ. Now that, of course, was challenged, and certainly challenged in this time, and represents really the debate and the disputation of what is going on here. It was certainly Martin Luther who, not completely throwing out that idea, but certainly altered it to more of a theory of consubstantiation, that certainly the body of Christ was behind the bread, perhaps not essentially transformed into it. And of course, in Protestant tradition today, we hold to a much more reasoned view, perhaps, that when we partake of bread and wine in the act of communion and remembrance, that we treat those elements as very symbolic of Christ's body and blood, that they don't actually mystically, in substance, truly become those elements, that we don't eat flesh or drink actual blood, but we drink wine or grape juice representing the blood, and bread, which represents, of course, the broken body of Christ. So all of this disputation is going on here. There are books on the steps here. Some of those books, it's hard to read, but some of them actually have titles on them that talk about logic and philosophy. There are philosophers here who are no doubt arguing, how could it be that bread could mystically transform itself into the actual blood of Christ, or the DNA, flesh, skin, muscle, tissue of Christ. How could that be? So there is all of this going on. Behind here, you will see that there is a building being constructed that is a Catholic church being constructed. And you'll see there is a temple here of philosophy, perhaps representing the school of Athens, that school of philosophy, representing in its entirety, in a way, the dispute of secular philosophers with revered Christian theologians who were holding to a view of what this substance, this bread, meant, and being engaged in deep debate and argument about the validity of that. Now, if we go above the clouds, we see a heavenly realm. Again, there's a lot of detail here in this realm. There are angels and cherubs, of course. They're holding four books. They're the four books, or the four gospels of the New Testament: Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. And we have the Trinity represented at the very center point in a line straight down. In fact, some have said that this painting by Raphael represents in some way a cross through this linear vertical phase and this horizontal lineup of all of these heavenly figures. And I'll go through them in just a moment. But we have the Spirit of God represented as a dove, just at the feet of the risen Christ, there holding his nail-scarred hands for all to see, at the center of enthronement in the glory of heaven. And above the Son, of course, is the Father, God the Father, blessing the world and holding in his hand the earth, a symbol of his absolute lordship over all creation as God the Father. And so the Trinity forms this line here. And next to Jesus, we have, of course, his mother, the Virgin Mary, Mary of Nazareth. And we have John the Baptist, who, in the role of John the Baptist, of course, is pointing towards Jesus as being the way, preparing the way, and always pointing to Jesus and giving him the glory. Now we have all these other figures across the heavenly realms here, and I will go through them because they are specific representations of biblical figures, but some also historical saints. We have, to begin with there, we have Peter, the apostle, and he holds in his hand the key. Of course, Peter holds the key to Hades. And then we have Adam there, without many clothes on, in his birthday suit, as Adam would be. Next to Adam, we have a very effeminate-looking male who is writing busily in a book, and that represents St. John the Evangelist, or John the Gospel writer, always represented within religious paintings of this period as being quite effeminate in appearance. Then we have a more elder-looking man holding a harp, and of course that is King David, representative of him. We have here an interesting saint. His name is Saint Lawrence. He's wearing purple. And next to him, sort of represented over sort of two sides, is a figure that's very important within Jewish history, though he's not specifically spoken of within the Protestant Bible, certainly within the greater apocryphal Bible that the Catholic tradition still use. That is Judas Maccabeus, an important figure from the history of Israel, particularly in that intertestament period when they were constantly in conflict with Seleucid empires, and then the Greek Empire, and then finally the Roman Empire. Next to Judas Maccabeus in his armor there, we have in green Saint Stephen the martyr, the first martyr of the early church. Then we have this figure holding, of course, stone tablets. Of course, that's Moses, and he has horns coming out of his head, as often were representative of Moses. Then we have this quite Christly looking figure here, who is actually James the Elder, or James the brother of Jesus. He's there. Next to him, we have a figure who's holding a knife. You think, well, who might that be? That's Abraham, of course, representing with the knife the story of Abraham and Isaac. And then finally, at the end, we have Saint Paul holding a sword in one hand, holding a book in the other. All of these religious figures in the pantheon of the heavenlies, alongside the throne of Christ himself, overseeing this disputation on the earth of what his body means. And of course, God the Father at the top there, as I said, and there are angels on either side flanking this divine heavenly scene. There are a lot of other details within this painting that I could refer to, but I think we really want to look at what this painting might still mean for us today and how we can appreciate it as followers of Jesus. I think what we can take from this painting is that there has been, there is, and there always will be, if we're honest, always some discussion, dispute, argument about elements of Christian theology that are just a natural and normal part of the church, certainly among believers of Jesus Christ, because we all, in our own human understanding, come with our own ideas, our own experiences, our own interpretations of what it means to be a follower of Jesus, and how we interpret that and understand that to translate into our practice as followers of Jesus, but also into our thinking and our theology as followers of Jesus. Certainly within this masterpiece, we have an argument about the nature of communion, the bread. What is it really? Does it really transform into the actual flesh and body of Christ? Or is that just taking it a bit too far? Is it really just more a symbolism, a form of our remembrance for how we contemplate and continue to live out the meaning of that act of what Jesus has done for us through his broken body become bread, through his spilled blood of the new covenant, which becomes very symbolic of our salvation and grace and newness. This debate going on is taken from a scene over 500 years ago. There would be similar church conferences, debates, councils that would take place in the modern day context. A photo could be taken of just equally as similar a scene of people who are passionately arguing for and defending their view of particular elements of our Christian doctrine and theology. So you might say that what this painting in essence represents is something that hasn't really changed a whole lot. There is still always disputation, argument, difference of opinion, contention around the elements of Christian faith, how we understand it, and Christian theology. That is still as relevant today as what it was 500 years ago. What I love about this painting, however, is that in the midst of all of this human contention, all of what's going on here, you have a heavenly scene that is really quite serene. There is no interference. There isn't anyone trying to get down here and whisper in someone's ear that actually, well, this is what it really is. There is a separation, if you like, between this heavenly realm and the realm of earth. But there isn't any sense when you look at Raphael's interpretation of the heavenlies here and the people within it, that there is anyone who is upset, or there's anyone who's concerned or deeply worried or frantically paranoid that the wrong thing is being understood. There is a sense of peace and serenity. In fact, we've got Stephen here who's looking the other way, like he's almost disinterested. You've got these others who are just talking to themselves, not really concerned about it at all. And at the very top of this amazing fresco painting is God the Father, still with the earth in his hands, in control of everything, but certainly not flustered or worried about what's going on down here. It speaks to me of the humanity of people as we are followers of Jesus, who desperately want to seek after the truth of mystical elements of our faith that we try to grasp onto, try to understand better. But in our humanness, we often find the understanding and the truth of such things slipping through our fingers. But we still try, and we still debate, and we still seek out truth. And that's what I take from this picture, the passion, the commitment of many here who are truth seekers, wanting to really know what the meaning of the bread is about, really wanting to put their view forward, really wanting to advocate for their particular theology. I think it's an amazingly liberating painting that reminds us that the church is a broad church, that we come to our faith with others who are on the journey with us as followers of Jesus. We come from many different backgrounds, many different positions, many places on the spectrum of theology. And yet we can and should and must always try our very best to disagree well with each other when we need to, on the issues that we feel passionate about that relate to God, theology, mission and practice. I think that's what this painting says to me, that this particular scene could equally be a scene from the church today, but that above everything, God is in control, and God is not flustered, and God is still God. And yes, we will always strive our best in our humanity, always in some ways falling short of ultimate wisdom and knowledge. But the effort that we make is worthwhile and necessary if we are going to truly call ourselves believers of the way of Jesus Christ. And to understand what this means, the sacrament, the bread, the body of Christ, the wine, the blood of Christ, to understand that for oneself is so important. Whether it means you grasp a truth to you that says that that substance is transubstantiated, that it actually becomes the body and the blood of Christ, or whether you believe in a more Protestant, liberal view that it's just purely symbolic, no matter where your belief finds itself, make sure that you have explored and that you come to a point of owning what you actually believe about this important remembrance of your faith journey with Jesus, in contemplating his sacrifice, his broken body, and his spilled blood. We're going to leave Raphael's magnificent fresco painting there, because there's much more I could say about it. But I pray that this week you might refer to this image, perhaps digitally, on your device, your phone. Have a look at it through this week. Have a look through all of the people within it. And perhaps more importantly, think deeply about how you understand communion and remembrance, and what the broken body of Christ and the spilled salvific blood of Christ mean for you, encapsulated within bread and wine. Let's pray. We thank you, Lord, for the magnificent creativity of people who were just like us, who somehow with their paintbrush just take us to places that are far, far beyond the normal of our realm here on earth. But they take us to places deeply spiritual. I thank you for this piece of art, which again reminds us of the power of Christ's broken body and his spilled blood, the sacrament, the Eucharist, what that means to us. Lord, may we always remember with meaning and intention just how deeply symbolic and significant your remembrance through the bread and the wine truly is for our life. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. A prayer of benediction I leave with you. May the love of God the Father and the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and may the fellowship and unity of the Spirit of God be with you this week as you live out the true meaning of Christ's broken body and his spilled blood in and through your life this week. Amen. God bless you this week. We're going to be back here next Sunday. It's an exciting Sunday next Sunday because we will find ourselves right on the Lunar New Year celebration day. The 11th of February this year is the Lunar New Year of the Dragon, and we're going to be looking at a piece of art which is a Russian icon from the Novgorod region, simply entitled Saint George and the Dragon. We're going to be looking at that artwork next Sunday, and of course celebrating Lunar New Year of the Dragon and what that means for particularly those who do celebrate the Lunar New Year so passionately. That's next Sunday. I'll see you then, and I look forward to it. Bye for now.